This program is brought to you by Emory University.
I'm Robert Shapiro, the Dean of Emory Law School, and it's my great pleasure to welcome you to this special occasion. I'm very glad that you are beginning your Martin Luther King Day celebration with us here this evening. Now, when we were thinking about who would be the ideal Martin Luther King Day speaker in this, our centennial year, it was clear to us what the right answer to that would be. It would be the president of the NAACP. I'd like to extend a special welcome to Cornell Brooks for taking time out of his busy schedule to be with us here this evening. I'd also say it's a personal pleasure for me, since Cornell and I were law school classmates a few decades ago. We were, in fact, in the same civil procedure class, a class I now teach, and we were reminiscing a little bit. I think we're actually paired in doing a complaint drafting exercise together in a civil rights case in civil procedure. It was rather a daunting introduction to the first semester of law school for me. It was clear, certainly back then, that Cornell was already in this first semester of law school an outstanding lawyer, an outstanding advocate, that he was going to be an outstanding leader. So in some ways, it's no surprise to me that his path led him to be the leader of the nation's oldest civil rights organization. I do want to say a few thank yous to the people who made this evening possible. I'd like to thank Amy Marcellana and the entire marketing and communications team of Emory Law School. I'd also like to give a special thanks to my colleague, Professor Dorothy Brown. Professor Brown had the vision for this Martin Luther King Day lecture series. She's a great champion of diversity and inclusion in our community, and I'd like to thank her for all she does to make our community a better community. Now, at Emory Law School, we seek to promote positive social transformation and advance the rule of law. We do that through the students we educate, the ideas we generate, the service we perform. A commitment to diversity is an essential element of all that we do. The inclusion of people from diverse backgrounds with diverse perspectives is a critical ingredient of the learning that goes on in our classrooms, the insights of our scholarship, the value of our service. Now, Emory has long been a leader in promoting diversity. In 1962, it was Dean Ben Johnson, Emory Law School class of 1940, and Chairman of the Board of Trustees, Henry Bowden, Emory Law School class of 1934, who brought the lawsuit that allowed private colleges and universities in Georgia to become integrated. That lawsuit transformed higher education in Georgia. It transformed the profession. It was part of a movement that transformed the world. However, along with a commitment to diversity, must be efforts to promote inclusion as well, and that remains an ongoing challenge. I'm grateful for our newly formed Diversity and Inclusion Coalition at Emory Law School, which helps us in our efforts to be a better community. Now, it's also the case that we honor the great accomplishments of Bowden and Johnson, not by mere historical reflection, but by ongoing commitment each and every day to work toward greater inclusion and diversity. They and others did not work so hard to make diversity merely a theoretical possibility. It must be a lived reality. Our task is to work every day to promote diversity and inclusion, to make sure that that is a principle that is true and we find diversity in our classroom, in our courtroom, in our boardroom. That is how we will continue this mission of ours. That's how we'll honor our past achievements. That's how we'll ensure our future success. That's how we will prepare our students to be leaders in the global environment of the 21st century. I would like to mention that one of the ways that we're promoting diversity is through a John Lewis Chair in Civil Rights and Social Justice. That chair will allow us to do a national search for a distinguished scholar with a demonstrated desire to promote the rule of law through the study of civil rights. The chair will honor the historic accomplishments of Congressman Lewis and inspire us to continue that legacy. We were pleased to be able to announce a lead gift of $1.5 million toward establishing that chair. And now we are seeking an additional $500,000 to fund the chair fully. We have $110,000 to go. And if you'd like to join that cause to allow us to complete that noble effort, you can speak to me or my colleague Robert Jackson this evening at the reception. Thanks, Robert, for doing that. All right. I would also like to mention that in connection with our centennial celebrations, we are hosting a talk by Congressman John Lewis at the National Museum for African American History and Culture in Washington, D.C. on March 22nd. And it would certainly be wonderful if we could complete the match, be able to announce it, and celebrate with Congressman Lewis on March 22nd. Well, again, thank you so much for everybody to being here. And now I'd like to call up the president of BALSA, Dion Robbins, to introduce our speaker. Please join me in welcoming Dion.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Dion Robbins, and I have the pleasure of serving as a president of Emory's Black Law Students Association. And it is my honor to introduce the speaker for this evening. Civil rights attorney, social justice advocate, coalition builder, and fourth generation ordained minister, Cornell Williams Brooks, the president and CEO of the NAACP. The NAACP is the nation's oldest, largest, and most widely respected grassroots-based civil rights organization. And Mr. Brooks has served as its chief executive since 2014. Born in El Paso, Texas, and raised in Georgetown, South Carolina, Mr. Brooks went on to earn a BA with honors in political science from Jackson State University, a Master's of Divinity from Boston University School of Theology, where he was also a Martin Luther King Jr. scholar, and a JD from Yale Law School, where he served as a senior editor on the Yale Law Journal. He has a long career advocating for social justice and civil rights. Mr. Brooks began his career as a judicial clerk with the then Chief Judge Sam J. Irvin III on the United States Courts of Appeals for the Fourth Circuit. He also worked as a staff attorney for the Lawyers Committee for Civil Rights under law and as executive director of the Fair Housing Council of Greater Washington. During Mr. Brooks' 4 years as a trial attorney for the United States Department of Justice, he worked to secure the then largest government settlement for victims of housing discrimination and filed the government's first lawsuit against a nursing home alleging housing discrimination based on race. Mr. Brooks also worked for 8 years as a special and senior counsel to the FCC, and he directed the Office of Communication Business Opportunities, working to increase financing for small and minority and women-owned businesses. Immediately prior to joining the NAACP, Mr. Brooks led the Newark-based New Jersey Institute for Social Justice. He also produced an award-winning documentary on criminal justice. During his tenure with the NAACP, Mr. Brooks has passionately led the association in the courtroom and in the community against racial profiling, police misconduct, and the full range of the NAACP's civil rights agenda. Mr. Brooks, thank you for taking the time to speak with us tonight. It is truly an honor. Please join me in welcoming the president and CEO of the NAACP, Mr. Cornell Williams Brooks.
Good evening. It is an extraordinary and humbling pleasure to be here at Emory Law School after these many years, and I'm so thankful to your dean that he did not mention the length of time between that ill-fated first assignment and now, which only goes to show that the sins of law school can be made up for in one subsequent career. I want to thank the dean for extending to me this extraordinary invitation, and certainly to the members of BALSA and Dion for that extraordinary, warm and generous and heartfelt introduction. I also want to thank my fellow BALSA member, I have not relinquished my membership, Willie Hill, if he's here, right, for your hospitality. I arrived here from Washington to the warm climes of Atlanta, and headed to, I think, Iowa and a couple other places that are considerably colder. I left my coat on the plane, and these two BALSA members helped me find my coat and get me to Emory Law School. So I certainly want to thank them for their hospitality. I want to thank the faculty and the administration for your hospitality and collegiality and making Emory Law School what it is and what it represents to these students. And certainly, I want to recognize President Francis Johnson, who leads, if you can just stand up, who leads the Georgia State Conference of the NAACP. Can you put your hands together? And recognize the leadership of Roger Johnson, who is with the NAACP Foundation here, and Richard Rose, who heads up the Atlanta branch of the NAACP. And if by chance there are any members of the NAACP in this audience, I want to thank you for being a part of the bravest and boldest band of freedom fighters this country has ever known. That would be the NAACP. Can you put your hands together for the folks who do the work each and every day? So tonight, we gather here at Emory Law School in an anguishing hour of our democracy. When we look across the length and breadth of our republic, we take note of the fact that we have a generation of millennial activists who have put their hearts, their minds, and their bodies on the line, and with their very being are yet declaring in streets and in courts and in legislatures that black lives matter. They do so understanding that black lives matter is the moral premise to the ethical conclusion that all lives matter. Unless the first is true, the second can never be true. This is a moment in American history where we see all across the country Americans of every hue and every heritage who are going to the ballot box understanding that the right to vote is not something that can be taken for granted. It is, in fact, a right that can be taken away. We are at this moment in our democracy yet seeing children and their parents standing up and standing against environmental racism in Flint, Michigan. We, at this moment in our democracy, yet see all across the length and breadth of this republic a rising tide of activism and democracy, because we know that this is a moment that is not ordinary. In fact, I'm reminded of a member of the board of directors of the NAACP and a first lady of the United States by the name of Eleanor Roosevelt, who yet declared in the Democratic Convention in 1940 that these are no ordinary times. This is a moment in our democracy where the times call out to each of us to stand up and stand against every form of oppression, every form of bigotry, every form of bias, every form of hate, and to do so unapologetically. This is a moment where civil rights is not a matter of something you read about, not a matter of something that you reflect on. It is a matter of lived experience, and it is happening as we speak. You see it on your Twitter feed. You read about it in the newspaper. You see it in the streets. You yet feel it in the courts. It is a moment in history that reaches out to all of us, the whole of our republic, lawyers and lay people, clergy and laymen and laywomen, people from every walk of life, because the moment yet speaks to us. And here we are on the eve of a celebration of an American prophet by the name of the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. We, on the eve of this annual celebration of his birthday, are yet having our ears and our hearts deafened by the cacophony of digital noise, tweets and posts, clamor and chaos in our streets, and we are yet yearning, listening for a voice that can bring reason and hope and inspiration and love to this moment. We yet need to hear the voice of a prophet in our times, in this moment, in the midst of this Twitter age civil rights movement. If we listen closely to the eloquence of example embodied in the life of the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., I would say to you that there are certain lessons that speak to us, that speak to this moment we find ourselves in. As a young seminarian at Boston University School of Theology, I studied Dr. King's social ethic and his moral philosophy, influenced by a group of moral philosophers called the Boston Personalists, including people like Harold DeWolf and Edgar Brightman. And there are three principles that speak to this present moment and yet even speak to a generation of lawyers. The first being is that every person is endowed with innate and intrinsic value by his or her or their creator. Second, that we as a society, despite the atomized existence that we live in, the digital walls of and cells of isolation that we find comfort in, that we are designed to live and to exist and to rely upon one another together. Third, that there exists in the midst of all that is going on, all the challenges, all the cynicism, all the pessimism, all the negativity about our republic, there exists a moral order. And so when we yet declare that the arc of the moral universe is long, but it bends toward justice, we say so not as a matter of description, but also as a matter of affirmation. Do we yet believe that right is right, just is just, and if it is not so, we can make it so? Dr. King, as a moral philosopher, as someone steeped in the philosophical tradition, was also steeped in the byways and the folkways, the theology and the liturgy of the Black church. And in the Black church, we understand that hope is not an ethical luxury. It is a moral necessity. And so we in this moment understand that hope is that which we cling to because we understand that we cannot merely describe what's going on. We have to hope and believe and work and pray that we can make it what it should be. And we do so out of a sense of moral confidence. And so at this hour, we, as citizens of this republic, can turn our hearts and our ears toward Dr. King to determine what we can do at this very moment. I'm mindful that we just survived the first presidential election in 50 years without the full protection of the Voting Rights Act. And this being a law school, you well understand that in the wake of the Shelby versus Holder Supreme Court decision, which gutted Section 5 of the Voting Rights Act via Section 4B, we've seen nothing less than a Machiavellian frenzy of voter disenfranchisement from one end of the country to the other. We have seen in our republic states like Texas craft and create a voter disenfranchisement bill and legislation and ultimately law that meant that if one possessed a concealed weapon permit, it was deemed sufficient civic and democratic proof to vote. But an ID which allowed you to walk across the campus of the University of Texas Law School or Baylor University, that ID was deemed insufficient democratic proof to vote. Or in the state of North Carolina, its state legislature passed an omnibus voter disenfranchisement bill
which meant that an ID which allows you to walk across the campus of Camp Lejeune or Fort Bragg was deemed sufficient civic and democratic proof to vote. But an ID which allows you to walk across the campus of North Carolina A&T, the University of North Carolina, or Duke University deemed insufficient civic and democratic proof to vote. We have seen all across the country and here in Georgia, voter registrations purged on the eve of elections. We saw in North Carolina thousands of voter registrations purged on the eve of an election. We have seen all across this country a fundamental assumption that the right to vote is sacred being upended. This is a moment in our country where our fellow citizens are not taking this lying down. May I remind you that within the ranks of the NAACP, we regard the right to vote as a civic sacrament currently being desecrated in the temple of our democracy. We cannot take this lightly because we understand that the right to vote can be measured in miles marched and martyrs created. We are mindful of the sacrifice of the Reverend James Reeb. We are mindful of the sacrifice of the seminarian Jonathan Daniels. We're mindful of the sacrifice of Viola Luuzzo. We're mindful of the sacrifice of Jimmy Lee Jackson. We're mindful that they gave their lives for the right to vote. And so, when the NAACP looks at the ballot box, we understand that the ballot box is not colored like an I voted sticker, red, white, and blue. The ballot box is literally colored with the blood, sweat, and tears of American citizens, and we will not give up the right to vote. So what have we done? We've reached out to a generation of lawyers and law students to take up arms against those who would take away the franchise. Over in Texas, we went to court, went to the Fifth Circuit, and literally rescued 630,000 votes and put those votes back in play. Over in the state of North Carolina, when 5% of the electorate 5% of the votes were imperiled by a constitutionally wrong-headed and morally wrong-hearted law. We went to the Fourth Circuit and literally put those votes back in play. Why? Because the Fourth Circuit yet declared that a state legislature had engaged in intentional racial discrimination carried out with surgical precision against your fellow citizens. And lest you think that this is a nostalgic matter of black and white, or brown and white, African-American and European-American, or Latino and Anglo-American, may I remind you, whenever you see voter suppression carried out in racial and ethnic terms, it's almost always carried out in generational terms. What happens when you move polling places from the college campus? What happens when you craft and create an onerous tax that you impose on students if they choose to vote where they live as opposed to where they came from? What happens when you say to young people that you don't have a place in this democracy, that you're being marginalized, that you're being asked to sit at the kiddie table of this republic? This is a serious moment for us as a republic. I'm reminded of our march from Selma, Alabama to Washington, D.C., what we called America's Journey for Justice. We marched from Selma, Alabama, across that state, across Georgia, into South Carolina, crossing North Carolina, into Virginia, and ultimately to D.C., a journey of 1,002 miles over the course of 43 days. We began in 103-degree heat, pavement at 109 degrees, heat index at 113 degrees. May I tell you about a friend of mine by the name of Middle Passage, a man 67 years of age, a veteran of the Navy, a veteran of the Vietnam War. We met him in Selma after he had ridden a bus for 40 hours to come to Selma. He didn't sleep at the foot of the Edmund Pettus Bridge, metaphorically, but literally. He then caught a ride with a rabbi to the home of Miss Amelia Boynton that he might pray to prepare himself for a pilgrimage dedicated to the right to vote. And when we met him at the foot of the Edmund Pettus Bridge, he told us that he wanted to walk all the way from Selma to D.C. and that he wanted to carry the American flag the entire distance. Middle passengers and I, Francis Johnson and I, members of the NAACP, members of the rabbinate, members of labor, members of the environmental movement, millennials and folks from the Motown generation marched side by side with Middle Passage for 40 days. We came to a small town in Virginia called Spotsylvania. We crossed through a rainstorm where Middle, being a veteran, kept the flag wrapped up. But when the clouds parted, when the blue sky emerged, when the sun came out, Middle unfurled the flag, and when he did, he collapsed to the ground. My hardest day at the NAACP was telling a group of students, not unlike yourselves, that Middle didn't make it. Didn't come back from the hospital, that his, as the doctors described it, his heart wore out. But the hardest question I've ever been asked at the NAACP is this. Those students asked me this question: if a man was willing to die for the right to vote, why can't we vote and fight for the right to vote? The question from those students should resonate in your hearts. Why can't we vote and fight for the right to vote? Why can't we vote and litigate? Why can't we vote and advocate? Why can't we vote and educate? Why can't we vote and put our bodies on the line? Why can't we vote and fill the jails? Why can't we vote and take a stand against injustice? Why can't we vote and literally model that which Dr. King gave us, which was a legacy of justice and service? The moment that we find ourselves in might be described in the terms of two scholars: Douglas Blackman, who referred to that period of penal servitude, which began after the Civil War, after during the period of Reconstruction and up through the 30s, 40s, and 50s, slavery by another name, and that ugly era of mass incarceration described by the scholar Michelle Alexander as the new Jim Crow. We find ourselves at a moment in American history where there are 2.3 million Americans behind bars, at least 70 million Americans with a criminal record, 1 million fathers behind bars. And not only that, we have a generation of Americans that have been stigmatized, dehumanized, demeaned by this prison industrial complex, this ugly architecture of exclusion which strips American citizenship de facto from American citizens. Consider this. A few years ago, an Alabama police officer, looking through the bottom of a rusty file cabinet, discovered two photographs, two black and white photographs of yesteryear, two sepia-toned photographs of a time gone by. One photograph depicted a young man with a precocious moral gravitas and a ministerial bearing. The other photograph depicted a somewhat older woman with a shy demeanor, disguising a fierce countenance of determination. The photograph of the young man was defaced with like the grime of graffiti on a wall with these numbers, 7089, 7089. The photograph of the somewhat older woman, the middle-aged woman, was similarly defaced, like the grime of graffiti on a wall with these numbers, 7063, 7063. We don't know the young man by his mugshot number. We don't know the young man by his criminal record number. We know him by his proper and given name, the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. We don't know the older woman by her criminal record number. We don't know her by her mugshot number. We know her by the name the school children the world over know her, Mrs. Rosa Louise Parks. Here we are in this era of mass incarceration, and we yet have to say that people are not defined by their mugshot numbers. They're not defined by their criminal record numbers. They're defined by their God-given dignity, something that Dr. King taught years ago, which is true today. This is the moment that we're in. Unless you think that this matter of mugshots and criminal record numbers being somewhat demeaning, may I share with you, having spent a little time in the Mobile Metro Jail, and having my mugshot displayed in the New York Times, that this was a culturally and morally expanding experience for me. Going into a jail as a consequence of an act of civil disobedience, and being cuffed and transported in a van for an hour with my hands behind my back with my colleagues. Then being taken into a precinct and being thoroughly searched in the most demeaning way, spread eagle, with your hands on a wall. Thinking about the film 13, thinking about what it's like to be chattel property and having someone inspect you, hold your limbs up to make sure that you're not dangerous. And then being thrown into a holding cell with brothers from all walks of life, but they are not for civil disobedience. And having one of my cellmates yet declare, seemingly disconnected from the conversation, I am a human being. I am a human being. Listening to him assert, I am a human being, I was reminded of the signs that Dr. King saw when he marched with Memphis sanitation workers, which said quite simply, I am a man. Dr. King's personalistic philosophy that every human being has intrinsic worth is still true. It is also true that there's a moral order to the universe. It is also true that we're connected to one another. Modern day scholarship, critical race theory scholarship, we talk about intersectionality, the work of Kimberly Crenshaw. Intersectionality of oppression, intersectionality of struggle, intersectionality of aspiration. But I'm reminded of an old school moral philosophical principle that Dr. King talked about, interdependence, that we are all reliant upon one another, that we all need one another, that we all have to make it through this world together, lest we perish together. And so in this Twitter moment, this Twitter age civil rights movement, I'm reminded that Dr. King's words are relevant. Dr. King's words speak to us. Dr. King's words inspire us, so much so that we cannot be a movement of nostalgia. We have to be a movement of now. It's not enough for us to romanticize Dr. King. without emulating Dr. King. It's not enough for us to study Dr. King without following in his footsteps. It's not enough for us to celebrate his life. We've got to emulate his sacrifice. How then can we say that we are in the midst of a Twitter age civil rights movement, a Black Lives movement, where we outsource the outrage, we outsource the anger, we outsource the righteous indignation, we outsource the struggle to the next generation? May I say to you, those of you who are self-respecting and self-legitimating law professors, you cannot leave this to your students. Those are the times we're in. Think about this. When Dr. King went to the White House before the Civil Rights Bill was passed and he met President Kennedy, they were walking through the White House and Dr. King saw a copy of the Emancipation Proclamation hanging on the wall. And he challenged President Kennedy to issue an executive order, a second Emancipation Proclamation. What then did he do? He went to his lawyers to get them to craft an executive order to take on segregation. There's a relationship between activists in the streets and advocates in the courts. And if you don't see your role, if you don't see how much you're needed, if you don't see how much children are crying out to you at this very moment, dear God, help the profession, help the bar. When I saw Philando Castile's mother in Minneapolis, and she put her arms around me, comforting me when it was my job to comfort her, I said, this speaks to me not as an attorney, but as a human being. I want you to imagine the mother of Freddie Gray, the mother of Philando Castile, the mother of Sandra Bland, reaching out their arms to you, to us as a profession, us as law professors, us as lawyers, us as judges, us as deans. A generation of Americans who are yet saying, we need you now, not later, not sometime in the distant future, but this moment, on this Dr. King's birthday. The profession is needed by those in the streets, so don't dare study his scholarship. Don't dare honor his life without emulating his example. Can I say this to you? Nothing prepared me for the moment we find ourselves in. I came to the NAACP a little more than 2.5 years ago. I unpacked my bags, or at least I tried to, in Baltimore at our headquarters. The second week was Eric Garner in Long Island. Thereafter, Ferguson, Tamir Rice, Sandra Bland, the Emmanuel Nine, and on and on and on. Hashtag videos. A hashtag homicides, viralized videos, everything on your Twitter feed, everything in the newspaper, everything on your television and on your radio is speaking to you at this very moment and saying, wherever you are, whatever job you hold, whatever role that you occupy in this life, emulate Dr. King's example. Come to the side of these activists. Stand at their side. And if by chance you're tempted to be cynical, you're tempted to be pessimistic about the possibilities of reform and change, may I leave with you these words, which are entombed in the rare book library on the campus of Yale University on faded manuscript, and that are yet written on the hearts of members of the NAACP across the country. The words would be these: lift every voice and sing, till earth and heaven ring. Ring with the harmonies of liberty. Let our rejoicing rise high as the listening skies. Let it resound loud as a rolling sea. Sing a song full of the faith that the dark past has taught us. Sing a song full of the hope that the present has brought us. Facing the rising sun of our new day begun. Let us march on, let us march on, let us march on, let us march on till victory is won.
Mr. Brooks has kindly agreed to take a few questions. So please, we have microphones set up.
Reverend Brooks, thank you so much for joining us today. My name is Kenneth Westbury. I'm an Emory Law student, a 2L here, and I volunteer downtown, work part-time at the Southern Center for Human Rights as a policy associate. I really appreciated what you mentioned, specifically regarding the criminal justice system. And specifically regarding voting, the context of voting, and despite the fact that Section 5 has been struck down, that there's no longer any preclearance requirements,
right.
I feel like there's state action to restrict the right to vote, but at the same time, I feel like that's more of a back-end problem. I think that a major problem is just people entering into the criminal justice system in some form or another, and felony convictions, preventing people from having the ability to access the vote. And I was wondering, what do you see is the next step for this? I know post-election, private prisons, their stocks increased tremendously. I guess I just like to get your view on all of that.
Sure. Sure. So, to your point about the relationship between exercising the franchise and the this era of mass incarceration. So I would note this, and we need to do this as a matter of appreciation. So over the course of the last 10 months, the NAACP has had 10 or so victories against voter suppression, not the least of which has been a couple of cases here in Georgia. The North Carolina State Conference of the NAACP securing a victory in the Fourth Circuit, the Texas State Conference of the NAACP securing a victory in the Fifth Circuit, and that, as you pointed out so rightly, in the absence of preclearance, having to in effect wait for a violation and then gather an army of lawyers, an army of activists, an army of experts at the cost of millions and millions of dollars, but also literally hundreds and hundreds of thousands of hours of time of people who are school teachers, police officers, firefighters, plumbers, because these cases can't be brought unless the activists are also in the streets. They go together. And so that's one half of the challenge. We are certainly working as hard as we can to get an attorney general, not being partisan, being focused on the record, an attorney general who's willing to support voting rights. So we testified before the House Judiciary Committee lifting up the fact that we need a Voting Rights Advancement Act. We need an attorney who understands what a violation of the Voting Rights Act looks like. We need an attorney general who understands that voter fraud is essentially voter fraud mythology, that out of a billion ballots cast, you have a little handful of fraudulent ballots. So there's a massive education effort that needs to take place on that side. We certainly have to litigate as much as we can, advocate as much as we can in Congress to get us an improvement to the Voting Rights Act. But now on the side of felon disenfranchisement, you know the numbers. Part of our challenge there is literally taking this battle into these state legislatures. Part of it, I would contend here, is legitimizing, and here this is like the ugly practice, ugly politics of respectability. How do we get people to respect the rights of people who've been formerly incarcerated if they don't regard people who've been formerly incarcerated as people? So when we use words like people returning home, we emphasize the noun, people, not just the verb. So part of this is doing things like passing ban the box, prison reentry legislation, which the New Jersey State Conference of the NAACP and my old group, we did a lot of in New Jersey. But you see that happening around the country. So I think it's important to put people with criminal records into the workforce. Number two, emphasizing that we want to ensure that people are accorded all the rights and responsibilities of citizenship, right? So in other words, talking about people returning home voting, paying taxes. So we emphasize that with this prison industrial complex, that's a million fathers behind bars and a significant number of mothers behind bars. So we talk about the overpopulation of prisons and jails and the underpopulation or depopulating of our families and communities. So part of it is literally helping people have a reframe. So when you go into these conservative state legislatures, they understand it's not enough for you to save money by doing some prisoner reentry. You've also got to save families and communities by helping people pay taxes and working and voting. But part of this is race, partisan gamesmanship. We don't want people with criminal records who are disproportionately black and brown voting. So unless we can help translate this battle into terms that everybody understands. In other words, when they take away their vote, your vote is in peril. So in other words, when we take away black and brown votes, the votes of young people are in peril. When we take away the votes of people who are returning home, the rest of our votes are in peril. So it's part of this is litigation, is legislative advocacy, but a massive part of this is public education.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening, sir. Thank you so much for your comments. I do want to say I thank you for the work that the NAACP does, and I also want to thank the local chapter, especially with the work that it did in the local Georgia election in helping citizens understand the need for a independent ethics review. Thank you so much. Sir, my question centers around a topic you touched upon. I was following your comments during the confirmation hearing of a one Jefferson Sessions.
Beauregard.
Jefferson Beauregard Sessions.
The third.
It seems like...
I can say that as Cornell Wayne Brooks.
It seems like we are having a change in leadership where we have a Justice Department that was vigorously fighting for LGBTQ rights, trying to hold back the militarization of police and defend basic liberties. And as a lawyer, but also as a citizen, I am concerned now with the direction the Justice Department will be taking. So I would like to hear your thoughts and advice for what citizens can do to essentially be watchdogs for our government.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much. First of all, I think we have to be very clear about what the civic options and the legal options are, the moral philosophical options. The options are not between, and the choice is not between conservatism and liberalism, but literally a Faustian choice between authoritarianism and democracy. So in other words, in the Senate Judiciary hearing, you had a group of senators talking about that this is a difference of philosophy. It's a difference of being conservative versus liberal. No, think about this. Here's a nominee who's consistently voted against all measures that would depopulate us, our prisons and jails, and populate our families and communities. Somebody who's voted against the COPS program, increasing funding for that, which supports community policing, which provides the bridge that brings police departments and communities together. Somebody who has said that they are opposed to consent decrees.
And when you think about Baltimore, when you think about Ferguson, when you think about Cleveland, those consent decrees are critical. I can tell you for a fact, in Ferguson, arriving there the second day after Michael Brown was killed, watching that community go up in flames, literally listening to gunshots being fired, people being on edge, talking to the mayor and the governor, and literally them being afraid for the state of their state and their communities. The consent decree is not something being rammed down the throats of the locals. It is something that the parties agree to and a court can give effect to, and it's a means of creating a bridge between police departments and communities. Critically important. So what I would say to you is we've got to make the case, certainly in the courts, right? We've got to mount this struggle in terms against predatory policing in the courts, critically important. It's also important here, frankly, for litigators to understand the public education value of litigation, right? So in other words, you don't bring cases without also thinking about how you can educate the public. So for example, when I worked at the Justice Department, one of the criteria for bringing a case was, if you bring this case, what is the public education value? Right? So we file this case. Is it going to help us prevent further violations of the law? We, in the private practice law, need to think about that too. Okay? Beyond that, I would say understand that our work takes place in the context of a movement that is anti-authoritarian. Be clear about this. Be clear about this. This is not about Democrat and Republican. When you have people openly talking about an immigrant ban against a global religion, when we talk about digital, ethnic, and racial profiling, when we talk about openly the internment of Muslims, and Korematsu is having the moral standing of, I'm not sure what, or lack thereof. The point being here is we are in the fight of our lives, and we got to be very clear about what the stakes are. And again, this is not about party. It's not about partisanship. It's not about liberal or conservative. It's about the Constitution. And when you have literally what we have going on in Washington, nominees being put forward without ethics checks, everybody being, it's sort of like, anybody ever been in the grocery store and there's the guy with a grocery cart full of 100 items in the 15-item lane? That's your nomination process. Again, a comprehensive strategy, courts, public education, again, activism, and being very clear about what the civic, moral, philosophical, political, philosophical choice before us, in terms of we're literally in a battle against authoritarianism. No hyperbole, no exaggeration. Just look at the law. Yep.
I'm from the Greene County, Georgia chapter of the NAACP.
Those none of the law students refer to me as Mr. President.
Anyway, when I was growing up in Greene County, we were always able to elect a black person. We were about 50, a little bit over 50%. Now we are about 30%. This is the first time during my lifetime that we were unable to elect anybody that looked anything like me and supported things that I believe in strongly. We were courted as a people. You know, we don't vote other than Democrat. We were courted by other persons in the Republican Party. No one was receptive. Now, my observation of life is when somebody wants something, they will give you a little bit of what you want if you support them. What are your thoughts on that? It's an anathema for black people to even consider anything but voting Democratic. But as for Greene County and other places, we will never be able to elect anyone that looks anything like us or even supports us. You know, Democrats will get your vote and give you nothing. That's been my observation in my county. What are your thoughts on that? And if you are open to a possible alignment, how would you approach our people with that possibility?
Let me, ma'am, just state at a threshold level.
As you well know, the NAACP is absolutely, strictly, religiously nonpartisan. Now, let me also make something clear, maybe as a matter of biography. My grandfather, Reverend James Prelo, ran for Congress back in the 1940s in the wake of the Smith versus Allwright Supreme Court decision outlawing the all-white Democratic primary. It was the Democrats who kept black people from voting. So in the 108-year history of the NAACP, we've seen Republicans do us in, we've seen Democrats do us in, we've seen independents do us in. And as my predecessor, Ben Hooks, once said, he said, I've been a Democrat, I've been a Republican, and I've been a do-nothing. Here's my point, ma'am. We don't have permanent friends or permanent enemies. We have allies who support our interests. And I'm simply saying to you, as a CEO of a nonpartisan organization who has some sense of the history, we have been supported by all kinds of folks. So you vote for whoever supports your interests. And as you well know, in 2012, we led the nation, having moved 1.1 million plus voters to the polls and voter mobilization. Now, once Democrats and Republicans wake up to the fact that the NAACP, on duct tape and shoestring, we move lots of people. So everybody should be paying attention to us. That's all I can say.
Hi, my name is Jordan Weber. I'm a 1L here at Emory Law. I'm originally from Dallas, Texas, where, so last summer during a... So last summer during a Black Lives Matter protest in Dallas, Texas, five police officers were tragically shot in downtown Dallas. Unfortunately, many in my community and in my city used that incident as an excuse to criticize the Black Lives Matter movement from a point of misunderstanding. So my question is, how can newer, more decentralized movements like Black Lives Matter or other movements learn from the history of the NAACP to be most efficient and most effective?
Sure. Here's what I would say, and I want to be like absolutely clear on this. All of us have to have some individual and institutional humility, right? So when I talk to, and when we talk to young activists who may not be steeped in the history of the NAACP, we come as partner, we come as colleague, we come as equal in this, as equals in this struggle for justice. Now, having said that, here's what I'll note. Police officers come in all colors, as we saw in Baton Rouge, as we saw in Dallas. Violence is wrong, no matter who perpetuates it. We're like very clear, we have called out police departments from one end of the country to the other. But can I tell you this, when we made the march from Selma to DC, 43 days, I had to call Governor Nikki Haley to say, I need police officers at that South Carolina border. Because there are people who are quite willing to kill us, not metaphorically, but literally, with guns and bullets, I say guns, bullets, and bombs. We've seen that. So we have a very good relationship with law enforcement where they want to support what we aspire to do. I think one of the ways we can cut through the rhetoric and the misperception is make clear everything a 19-year-old and 17-year-old activist calls for makes police officers safer. Everything. When they call for civilian review boards, it makes you safer. When they call for more community policing, it makes you safer. When they call for body cameras and vehicle cameras, it makes you safer and creates accountability. When they call for consent decrees, here's what some of your leading police chiefs will say to you behind closed doors. Thank God for those consent decrees, because I can push these police officers to do what they know they should do. And when the president of the United States, the leader of the free world, spends 5.5 hours in a meeting in the White House with me, Mark Morial, the urban lead, NAACP, and young activists that I met on the streets of St. Paul and Minneapolis. Why is he doing that? He's doing that because he understands that in this movement, we need everybody. And oh, by my side was the head of the Fraternal Order of Police. Because here's what happens. When I was in Minneapolis after Jamar Clark, on the same corner that we were on, less than 24 hours after I left, five of my colleagues were shot by white nationalists.
The same people that hate us hate police officers. People who are addicted to violence are addicted to violence, and they'll perpetuate it against anybody. And so we've always said, of course Black Lives Matter. We're very clear about that. We've been clear about that since the turn of the century. But that's not unrelated to all lives matter, whether your skin is black or your uniform is blue.
Good evening, Dr. Brooks. I'm a junior in Emory College. And so my question is, how do you deal with the almost guilt of having your feet in different places and not being able to do everything? So I know for me as a student, I organize on campus, but when there are things going on in Atlanta, like community meetings and things, I can't go because I have class or exams. And then I feel bad because I have other friends who may go to school in the AUC, and they're at all the rally meetings, or they can be there all the time. So how do you sort of deal with, okay, I'm doing voter registration, but I'm not at the march. Like, I'm at this protest, but I wasn't at that one. And how do you find the balance and still feel confident that you're working towards the movement and that you're being beneficial, but understanding that you're just one person, you can't be at everything?
Well, it sounds to me like you have your own answer, but I'll just tell you this. So as a Methodist preacher, I went to seminary before law school, right? So I suffer from chronic guilt to this very day. So it's a hazard of the profession. But here's the one thing I would say. We have to have a certain moral confidence, right? In other words, you have to be confident that what you're doing in the space in which you're to do it is enough. Because keep in mind, one story I really love is Rosa Parks, 10 years before she sat down on a bus in Montgomery, she stood up for a black woman who was raped by a group of racial vigilantes. Nobody knew about that. It wasn't in the newspaper, it wasn't in the New York Times. But what she did for that black woman as a criminal investigator, years before Law and Order SUV and rape crisis centers, this was a seamstress who was standing up investigating a case of sexual violence. She did what she could, and it was enough. And I'm saying what you do is enough, because if you go to a protest and you want to make the dean's list and you want to have a social life, you know, in my guilt, you know, guilty world, and you want to make it to church somewhat on time, no, all this is all right, right? Give yourself a pass. Yeah.
So obviously things have changed quite a lot since the 60s and the previous civil rights. And I think we can all agree one of the biggest changes is with regards to technology. We now have cell phone cameras and it's clear that that helps organize protests and things of that matter, but I've also heard it claimed that there are some people who just retweet something and then they don't really do anything else. So what are your thoughts on both how technology and social media have made things better and worse?
Sure. It's an excellent question. So in short, my tweetable response to that would be that the method is not the movement, right? So if we go back to the Montgomery boycott, the sisters at Alabama State University had a piece of pre-Twitter technology called the mimeograph machine. They cranked out tens and tens of thousands of flyers, which helped make the movement more effective, but it was not a substitute for people actually boycotting the buses. So the technology is incredibly important. So when we were arrested in Mobile, we knew we had to go with a small group of people. We couldn't go, you can't take over a senator's office like, 1,000, particularly when they buzz you in. But we also had Facebook Live. So we had 500,000 of our friends watching all of this happen. And the folks at the New York Times and the Washington Post paying attention to it. And people half my age were like, okay, we're gonna do this, we're gonna do this.
here's the point. The technology is incredibly, incredibly important. But we have to understand that the technology gives effect to the plan. The technology gives effect to the moral grounding, right? So in other words, it's incredibly important that we not think that the technology is cause and effect. It's simply the means. That's all it is. And when we take a kind of utilitarian view of the technology, when we embrace it, but we also have to embrace the culture too. And here's what I mean. If within the NAACP we got grandparents, they don't want you to tweet them. Right? Mr. President, we're not reading your little tweets. You got to call me. Right? We got to honor that. Francis Johnson knows what I'm talking about, right? We got to honor that, but we also have to say, sister, you know, your grandchildren are tweeting too now, so why don't you read what they tweet, right? So in other words, we have to be aware of the kind of digital culture and the fact that in an intergenerational movement, and it must be an intergenerational movement, we have to bring technology and the people together. I mean, that's just so important. Like, for example, when a sister told me I was the first person to desegregate my place of employment, I said, ma'am, how old are you? You're 70? I want you to talk into my phone. I need you to tell your grandkids what that was like. And I'm gonna put that on the internet. She said, really? I said, you feel comfortable with that? She's like, yeah. I said, now, I need you to go home and ask somebody to show you what you just did.
Thank you.
I see we have three people at microphones. How about we take these as the last three questions?
Good evening, Mr. President. My name is Quinston Coleman, and I'm the Vice President of the Chattanooga Branch NAACP. I'm one of those people you talked about who came through the struggle, being one of 11 students out of 1,600 students to integrate Chattanooga High School in 1968. My question... I didn't intend to say that. My question is that as I see all of these great minds and willing workers in this room, how do we reconnect New York and the Legal Defense Organization with Baltimore? Because both are necessary. We need the active people in the streets. We need the educational component. But then we need to know that we have the supports. And I see no better place to start than right here and challenge these young lawyers to think about that, because we need to come back together and work collectively. I've dealt with Ben Cheney and others from New York. I've dealt with Morris Deese down in Montgomery. And every time that I get to the point where we can make a change, or an effective change, we get sidetracked because we don't have that cohesive synergy that comes from those two major organizations coming together to fulfill the role that they started out to do. Can we expect at some point in time that we can see that coming back together?
Sure. So for those who may not know, the NAACP and the NAACP Legal Defense Funds, having started together, the LDF being the legal department of the NAACP, that we split many years ago. Now, that being said, when I came to the NAACP, Sherilyn Eiffel, who is the director of counsel, as you know, of the Legal Defense Fund, one of the things that we talked about was collaborating, working together. So, for example, giving honor and credit where credit is due. When I had the opportunity to testify before the House Judiciary Committee, Sherilyn Eiffel was two rows behind me. Sherilyn Eiffel, giving credit and honor where it is due, she had her staff help us prepare the testimony. She had her staff tweet and text and email me literally throughout the night in terms of points to make, how we want to strategize. When we go to court, we partner, we collaborate. So a part of this is that it is the crush of circumstance. The moment we're in right now does not lend itself to these false distinctions, to these old divides, certainly not within our movement. So I hear you absolutely loud and clear, and I just want to say to you that we're endeavoring to do that. Certainly with the Lawyers Committee for Civil Rights, we do work with the Advancement Project. But part of this is among the legacy organizations, but it's also among the younger organizations, right? So we're endeavoring to be clear, like on the Women's March, we want to support that. With NAN, we want to support that. We want something we're doing in Washington called the People's Inaugural, right? Where we are on the campus of Howard University, and it is a millennial summit. So basically, millennial NAACP members are conducting their own summit, and they've extended me quite graciously an invitation for me to do my part and leave, right? Respect that, okay? But the point being is we're trying to create some intergenerational collaboration as well as collaboration among the legacy organizations. Yeah.
Hi, this might be a bit too tall. My name is Amanda. I'm a 1L at Emory. First of all, as a future lawyer, I just wanted to thank you emphatically for your testimony at Jeff Sessions' nomination, because you represented a lot of us who obviously couldn't say those things ourselves. My question is, the LGBT community, transgender specifically, have faced a lot of discrimination and violence, specifically black trans women. Mm-hmm. What are you planning on doing to protect those minorities of minority groups in the coming 4 to 8 years?
Sure. So one of the things we did, for example, in the testimony is make clear the senator's record with respect to extending hate crime protections to members of the LGBT community. That was a significant part of the testimony. The witness, two people to my right, that's part of her testimony. And not only have we done it in the context of testimony, but also in terms of lobbying. So when we go to the Hill, we're very clear about this. We stand in coalition. In the wake of the Orlando attacks, we went to the Human Rights Campaign and said, the NAACP needs to stand beside you to make clear, in the NAACP, we represent moderates, liberals, conservatives, theologically and otherwise. We got all that. I'm a fourth generation preacher. We got all that too. But when it comes to hating people, when it comes to marginalizing people, we believe in civil rights. We're clear about that. And the civil rights for everybody. And so in terms of our lobbying, in terms of our framing, if you look at North Carolina and the great work that Reverend Barber's doing there, we talked about HB2, right? We talked about HB2 not just as a anti-LGBT bill, but also an anti-labor bill, anti-civil rights bill, because we want to frame it not just cosmetically, not in terms of marketing, but on a visceral moral level, right? Because that's a big part of the NAACP's work. We're like the translators and transliterators, if you will, of civil rights causes to middle America. So when we go on, you can talk to Vibe or you can talk to New York Times, but a big part of our job is translating. So we totally get it, and if you have any more ideas in terms of what we can do in terms of advocacy at the grassroots level in Washington, messaging, media, always willing to hear more ideas, always. Please. And may I say this? You will hear, probably not at Emory Law School because the people here are too bright, but elsewhere, you will hear people say things like, the NAACP is geriatric and the NAACP is retired. Well, I'm just here to tell you, we are not in the convalescent home, and for the folks who think that, all I ask is, where are you on Twitter? Are you reading your newspaper, watching your television? Because you have 2,200 units of the NAACP in all 50 states, and I can tell you, these people work around the clock, and they call me around the clock. So give me. Is he the last? Yeah, you're the last, ma'am.
Last one. Yes, ma'am. My name's Laura, and I'm a seminary student.
Thank you. We got one.
I was very excited to hear you tonight. As much as I cannot stand our president-elect, I feel convicted that I cannot root for his failure because he's rich now and he'll be richer when he leaves. And I know that his failure is just going to be the hurting middle and lower class Americans of every race and background. And so my question is, how can the NAACP and everyday Americans fight for civil rights with unresponsive administration and state legislatures?
So we are in a similar place, right? In the sense of we don't root for the failure of any president. We are not partisan, right? We just are not. When the president-elect won, we sent a letter, issued a press release that said, to the extent that this administration demonstrates fidelity to the Constitution, we will be at your side or in your face. These two are conditional and they go together. So to the extent that the president needs a reminder from time to time about that the Constitution is not a piece of parchment that is literally stained with the blood, sweat, and tears of Americans, we're gonna remind him, whether it be through litigation, whether it be through activism at the state level, at the congressional level. So we engage. We engage behind closed doors. We engage in the streets. So in terms of a multivalent strategy, first thing I got to say, everybody needs to join the NAACP, right? Just got to say that. Got to say that, right? You know, there's a little expression we have within the NAACP, don't talk about it, be about it. Right? And so that means you can't talk a good game, you gotta be a good game. And that means literally joining the NAACP, number one. Number two, getting active, getting engaged, using your legal skills. Because I can tell you, what happens when you have people in small towns who want to go before the city council and push for an ordinance, or go to the state legislature and push for a piece of legislation? Where are the lawyers? Who helps you prepare testimony? Who tells you where to stand, what to say? What can you say? You need lawyers. You need law students. Yes, and we need seminarians. Because here's the reality. Who frames dry public policy issues in the language of values? Because most people do not vote on a cost-benefit analysis. Contrary to what they teach us in law school, people do not vote purely in terms of profit maximization, right? The people vote based upon their sense of right and wrong, their sense of fairness. And so seminarians are incredibly important here. But I'd say join, be active, bring your skill set, and push us. Push us. We all need that right now. With that said, thank you.
President Brooks, thank you so much for sharing your wisdom with us. I can't imagine a more timely or important talk. Again, and please join us for a reception outside. We'll be able to continue the conversation thereafter.
Thank you.
Good evening.